We thank you. We can't thank you enough this morning, Father. I just want to just stay there for a moment, Father, and just say thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
We have to listen, we have to hear, Father. We just want to pause and say, John, this morning, Father, and say thank you.
Thank you.
For being you.
Yeah.
Kenya right now. It's a church up in the air. Is it in Kenya?
Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah. For me. Blessings and glory and honor.
May all belong to you.
Thank you, Jesus. For blessing me. Amen.
My dad used to use my phone number.
Morning.
Our reading will be coming from Mark 3, and we will be reading from the New Living Translation.
Mark 3.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
He is who God graduate, that means he's smart. Of American Baptist College with a master's of divinity from Church of God Theological Seminary, and has been preaching the gospel for more than 30 years.
Amen. Amen.
Originally from Sherrill, Indiana, you won't hold that down. Pastor Wakefield stepped out on faith to fulfill the vision of Freedom Fellowship Christian Church in Knoxville, Tennessee. Supported by his lovely wife, and his two sons, Jeremy and Justin, Pastor Wakefield has been devoted to his congregation at Freedom for 20 years. And there is more, but I'm going to get out of the way and introduce the son and present to others the dynamic Pastor Wakefield.
Amen.
Is our pastor here today?
He's on sabbatical. He's on sabbatical the whole month of September. He'll be back next Sunday.
Pastor Wakefield has been. The church say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. It's definitely
indeed
an honor and privilege to be before you on today. And we do give honor to God and to your pastor in Jackson. He's a dear friend of mine and a great man of God, a wonderful pastor.
Amen.
To the church and to your leadership, to your hospitality. We're going to thank you for all that you've done and for this melodious choir.
Amen. Amen.
Good to be here at St. John Alcove. This is not my first time being here, and I thank God for another invitation to come and to share this worship experience with each and every one. So right now, we'll go and get right into the Word of God. We'll look at the Gospel of Mark, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. We just read it in your hearing. I'm going to read it again from the New Living Translation. You may remain seated. Mark 3, 1 through 6 from the New Living Translation. It says, Jesus went to the synagogue again and noticed the man with the deformed hand. Since it was the Sabbath, Jesus' enemies watched him closely. He healed the man's hand. They planned to accuse him of working on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the deformed hand, come and stand in front of everyone. Then he turned to his critics and asked, does the law permit good deeds on the Sabbath, or is it a day for doing evil? Is this a day to save life or to destroy it? But they wouldn't answer him. He looked around at them angrily and was deeply saddened by their hard hearts. Then he said to the man, hold out your hand. So the man held out his hand and it was restored. At once the Pharisees went away and met with the supporters of Herod to plot how to kill Jesus. I want us to be prayerful of the message this morning and on the topic, the advantage. advantages of going to church.
Amen.
The advantages of going to church. Now, this is probably more for the people that are not here, so I need you to help me preach this, and you can share with others the advantages of going to church. Because just as it was read out of my bio, I've been in the preaching ministry for over 30 years now. Some of the things that I have to say today, I never saw it coming when I was younger. I never thought that I would have to encourage even people who profess and proclaim to be the people of God to come to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
That you would have to convince people that there is an advantage to being at church. But when you take a look at scripture, it helps us to know that there is definitely an advantage when it comes to being at church. When you take a look at Mark, the first chapter, what you will notice there is that Jesus attended the worship services in the synagogue. That is one of the first times in scripture that is recorded that Jesus went to church. And so while he was there, here Jesus is presiding, and while he's presiding, he comes in contact with a man who has an unclean spirit. So for the Bible readers, you will know that a person with an unclean spirit means that they were demon-possessed. Now, I want you to understand the scene as well as the setting, because here Jesus is in a worship service. Jesus is the one who is presiding. And then he comes in contact with a man who is possessed by the devil. Mm-hmm. Here we are in the house of God, with the Son of God, anticipating the word from the Lord. And here he comes in contact with, and he encounters, a person with an unclean spirit. What does that tell us? What does that teach us? That lets us know that even the devil comes to church.
Amen. Amen.
When the devil comes to church, we need to understand one thing. He can never come on his own and by himself. He always has to have transportation.
Yes.
And so the question for this morning is, who gave the devil a ride to church?
All right.
But as a seasoned Christian, as a mature believer, we need to expect that the devil is going to show up.
Yeah.
That just because you're within these sacred walls, that does not give you an exemption from satanic influences. And it doesn't always give us the respite that we're looking for from satanic activity. But the devil himself will come to church.
Amen.
The good news is this, is that while the devil was in attendance, Jesus was presiding.
Amen. Amen.
That means that Jesus, the one that was in charge, Jesus, mm-hmm. the one that was in control, Jesus was still present, although the devil was at.
Right.
So what we need to understand is no matter how much satanic activity happens within these sacred walls, that Jesus is still in control.
Amen.
He's still presiding. That he still sits high and looks up. Help us children. He can receive and know.
Amen.
So when we take a look at church, first and foremost, what we see is a man in Mark the first chapter with an unclean spirit. But then when you look at Mark the third chapter, right in verse 1, it says Jesus came to church again. Okay. You know, I'm trying to rush through this, but each phrase says, preach me, preach me.
Yes.
Because it was customary for Jesus to go to church.
Amen.
And that's why it's important for you and me to also attend the worship services of our God. It's important for us to be in contact and connected with the family of God, the people of God, especially mature saints of God. It's important for us to make it a part of our life and a part of our routine to come to church. Jesus, with all of his holiness, found it necessary to go to church. And if we call ourselves Christians, which means that we are Christ followers.
Yes.
And how much more important is it for you and me to go to church?
Amen.
So here Jesus goes to church, and at first he ran into a man with an unclean spirit, but now he runs into a man with a deformed and useless hand. It lets us know that this man, in the King James Version, suffered from a withered hand. He had a hand that was useless, and he had a hand that was deformed. In other words, this man suffered from a disability. But he is in the worship services of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I wish you could see this with your sanctified imagination, because what I appreciate about this man is that he didn't allow his disability nor his deformity keep him from the house of God.
Amen.
In spite of his brokenness, in spite of his humanness, in spite of his frailness, he still pressed his way to the house of the Lord. Too often we make flimsy excuses for not participating in the worship experiences of God.
Amen.
Press his way.
Yes.
Can you utilize your sanctified imagination with me for just a little while? Because I'm just wondering what would have happened for the man or to the man if he hadn't been worshipful that particular Sunday. He would have missed out on Jesus.
Amen.
He would have missed out on his healing.
Yes.
He would have missed out on his
healing. Yes.
Challenges in the work of ministry. And just because you made up your mind to serve God doesn't mean that the devil's going to leave you alone.
All right.
But there's always going to be some haters in the house.
Yes.
There are always critics.
And yes.
You know the job of the critic is, the critic's job is to criticize.
Amen.
And you don't get an exemption from criticism. They will challenge you, they will criticize you, they will confront you. There's always haters hating on you, even while you're in the house of the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
I'm here to tell you that in spite of all of that, in spite of unclean spirits, useless hands, and unholy leadership, it still advantages to come to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
You know, somebody else said it like this. They said, you know what, I don't have to go to church in order to be a Christian. And you know what I would say to that is that you are absolutely right. You don't have to go to church in order to be a Christian. And you might be married, and you don't have to go home in order to be married. But I guarantee you, if you don't show up, that would be a
second. Yeah!
It's important for us to come together and to convene corporate in the house of God, because it strengthens us as the people of God. And not only should it strengthen you, not only should you come to receive, but you ought to come to contribute.
Amen.
People that come to receive whatever it is that the church service has to offer. We should not merely come as consumers, but we need to be contributors.
Amen.
What is it that God has put down on the inside of you for the benefit of somebody else?
Amen.
See, too often, even when we search for our church homes, we look to see how is it that they're going to bless me? How can me being there benefit me? How can or what can I receive from them as a result of being a part of that ministry?
Mm-hmm.
But what we really need to be asking is, what can I contribute?
Yes,
in
Lord.
In what ways can I serve?
Yes.
How can I help somebody?
Yes.
God.
Yes.
God never intended for us to be reservoirs of selfishness. He always intended for you and for me to be a channel of blessing.
Amen.
And just like he has blessed you.
Yes,
it
Lord.
Be, as he blessed you, you should be on your
Amen.
Way to be a blessing
to someone else. Yeah.
It lets us know that, yes, there are problems with the local church, but then there's also the presence of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank God for the presence of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank God that he shows up in the worship experience. I thank God for the word of God.
Yes.
Thank God for the people God.
Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes.
I'm telling you that I've experienced many advantages, many blessings, many benefits as a result of coming to church.
Amen.
It was when I came to church that I heard the plan of salvation for the first time and gave my life to Christ and he saved my soul.
Amen.
It was at the church that I said I do to my spouse for now 32 years.
Amen.
It was at the church that we dedicated our first son and gave him back.
Yes, Lord.
They convened around me and they licensed me and then ordained me to preach the gospel.
Yes, yes.
All of the greatest blessings and experiences that I've had in my life has happened
at the church. Amen.
In the presence of Jesus the Christ. What I like about this man with the deformed hand is his perspective. You know what? Because he could have easily allowed for his disability to keep him from the house of the Lord. He could have allowed his brokenness to keep him from coming to church. But then it makes me also wonder, maybe it was because of his brokenness that he made it out to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Have you ever come in contact with those individuals that I call crisis Christians? And you know when something bad has occurred in their life because they're at church on that Sunday. The only time they seek the Lord's face is at the time or in the time of a crisis.
Amen.
As long as things are going well in their life, you won't see them at any worship services, and they won't render any service unto God. They won't sing in the choir or play any instruments or serve on the deacons or trustees.
Amen.
They won't serve and work and participate in ministry. Why? Because everything seems to be all right.
All right.
And the sun is shining in their life.
Yes.
Living in a nice home, driving a fancy
car. Yes, yes.
There's money. There's money in their pockets or pocketbooks that you won't see them at the
house. All right, tell him.
But then let trouble come.
Yes.
Some
uh-huh. Yes. Yes.
As a matter of fact, they will give God at that time their undivided attention.
Amen.
They're no longer sitting in the back of the
sanctuary. Preach.
Yes. They will be distracted at all by things that might be taking place around them. That's a crisis Christian. Sometimes I believe God allows for our brokenness because he knows that when we're broken, that's the time that we'll stay the closest to him. He allows for perpetual pain in your life and in my life because he knows that if he blesses us like he really wants to, that we would abandon him.
Yes.
As long as there's a perpetual painful situation in our life, then we will remain close to him. And you know what I've discovered? Anything that keeps me close to the Savior cannot be all that bad.
All right.
Together
for the good. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes.
He didn't say everything feels good, but it's working out
for the good. All right, now. You better tell it. Yes.
Chaos and challenges and confusion in your life and in my life, that's when we learn to call upon the name of the Lord.
Yes. He wants to be inconspicuous. He wants to go unnoticed. But when Jesus sees him, he calls him from the back to the front. The young folk would say it like this, because Jesus said, stand forward.
That means come up to the front. Not only did he come up to the front, but then he turned him around and made him face the crowd.
All right.
The young people would say, Jesus, just put the man on blast. he just exposed the man, all of his weaknesses, all of his frailty, all of his shortcomings, all that was wrong with him, all of the troubles in his life. Jesus just exposed him, and he, in essence, was telling the congregation that had gathered, look at this man. Can you imagine how uncomfortable he must have felt at the time? He's standing in front of the awaiting congregation at the command of Jesus, and they are now staring at him and all of his frailties and his shortcomings, his deformity, and his disability.
Amen.
Has the Lord ever done that to you, where he just pulled back the covers on you and exposed and revealed what was wrong with you for others to look upon and even talk about and discuss over the dinner table? That's exactly the way this man, he was treated by Jesus. It made me wonder, why would Jesus call the man forth and tell him to stand forth? He exposed the man's disability. The man probably covered the hand because he didn't want other people to know what was wrong with him. He was trying to conceal the challenges in life.
All right.
That he was going through. But Jesus said, stand forth.
Yes, yes.
I'm here to tell you every now and then, Jesus will tell you to stand forth. To expose what's wrong with you, to expose your weakness, to expose your frailty, to expose your shortcoming. But this is what we need to understand. Whenever Jesus calls you forward, whenever Jesus tells you to stand for it, it's not for the purpose of humiliation. It's for his glory.
Amen. Amen. Yes, Lord.
Then he told him to stretch for it.
Uh-huh.
Oh,
all right. Yes, yes.
I'm looking for the Bible readers that pays close attention to what the Word of God says, because he not only told him to stand for it, he told him to stretch for it.
Yes, Lord.
Could it be that God has placed you on blast and exposed you because he's trying to stretch you? Because he's trying to get you outside of your comfort.
Yes.
Get you out of the normal routine that you've been involved in. He says, not only stand for it, but stretch for it.
Yes.
And guess what? When this man followed the commands of Jesus, he was then able to do what he was never able to do before.
Amen.
He stretched forth his hand, and his hand was restored.
Amen.
Others to see the process of restoration and deliverance. He